when I was preparing for this, I went back to the ILO, which has been our, you know, what shall I say, guru in all matters of work and decent work. And I found the definition said decent work is work that involves opportunities for work that is productive and delivers a fair income, security in the workplace, and social protection for families, better prospects for personal development and social integration, freedom for people to express their concerns, organize, and participate in the decisions that affect their lives, and equality of opportunity and treatment of all women and men. So decent work, co-ops for decent work. The reason I mention this is, what better structure, what better framework do we have than cooperatives to realize this wonderful vision of fair and just and non-exploitative work? Cooperatives also have the added advantage in our experience of being democratic workers' organizations. There's a very nice fit with unions. Unions and cooperatives in our experience go very well together. They are democratic workers' organizations where the shareholders themselves are the users, managers, they run the cooperative, and the owners, as all of you know, and the surplus is shared equitably as dividend. The other important point is that cooperatives present a forum where the voice of shareholders, of the poor, and those who are normally excluded, like women, minorities, and other disadvantaged castes and communities, have a voice and have representation. Third, cooperatives embody certain values, as we've been hearing from morning. And as far as Sewa is concerned, it's an organization that is inspired by the life and work of Mahatma Gandhi. We find that the values of Gandhiji and the values, the cooperative principles, really match. So for all these reasons, we think cooperatives are ideal for implementing the vision of decent work. Ours is a long association with cooperatives. The first association came when we tried to, like our friends and sisters and brothers in Korea, when we tried to make our own bank. Poor women came together in their own union and said, we cannot come out of poverty because we are bound hand and foot to money lenders. We borrow 100 rupees a day and we have to return that 100 rupees with 10 rupees. So 10% interest per day. These were self-employed women like street vendors, vegetable sellers, flower sellers, fish sellers. So they said, we want access to finance. We want banks to give us a safe haven for our savings and line of credit. They went to the then nationalized banks in 1974, and I'm sorry to say, the banks slammed the doors shut. The banks took one look at these poor women and said, these women are not bankable, not possible. It was then that the poor women, 4,000 women at the time, organized into our union, Sewa, said, we are poor, but we are many. Each one of them gave only 10 rupees, their daily wage at that time. And with 40,000 share capital, very much like our Kerala brothers' experience, the bank, they went to the Reserve Bank of India officer. He took one look at these women and said, we can't give you a bank. What is this? You are a bunch of illiterate women. There'll be a disaster if you run your own bank. They stayed up overnight. They learned how to sign their name. They went back to the officer and said, we want our bank. No one will have us. We want our own cooperative bank. He was so moved, he gave them the license on the spot. And from 40,000 rupees, today, Sewa Bank, still small by world standards, is 3 billion Indian rupees with 6 lakh depositors. And these are all people who earn hardly 100, 200, 300 rupees a day. The bank has its own board of elected women, the same women who were street vendors and others. The second experience we had was when we were organizing garment workers in the city of Ahmedabad, where Sewa, our union, was born. We struck for minimum wages, and the contractors and owners broke our struggle. They knew we were living down to the wire. They knew if they didn't give us work, our children would starve. And it was then that the women said, we know how to sew. We can sell our own goods. Why not we form our own unit? And that unit they called Sabina. They happened to be Muslim women from the city of Ahmedabad. And Sabina was our first handicraft or artisan cooperative. And they began to work and they began to earn in a non-exploitative way. The other important point was that by chance we found hit upon a good strategy of working with poor workers. What we found is that when they had their own cooperative, more and more women were attracted to the cooperative because they got better wages, naturally. So the contractors and the owners who were exploiting the women till then had to raise the wage rate. And therefore, we struck upon, by chance, a very good strategy of organizing into union and cooperatives for struggle and development and having a direct impact in the labor market. Today, we have 106 cooperatives. Each of them has its long story. I will not go into those now. And 12 cooperatives in other states of India. So what did we learn? I just have two more points. What did we learn from this journey of 45 years? First and foremost, through cooperatives, we can get decent work and proper income. We no longer have to beg for work and employment in front of exploitative landlords or merchants who do not give us decent work and fair wages. Also, cooperatives are inclusive. We have women from all castes, communities, religions, different geographies, all united together for their own livelihoods. Second, it's close to their homes. It's decentralized. It's the vision of the father of our nation, Gandhiji, taking employment right down to the grassroots level to where people live and work. Second, as I mentioned, it acts as a lever in the labor market. We are no longer dependent on exploitative forces. We have our own way of generating employment and livelihood, and then, of course, they have to raise the wage rate. Third, social security. In our country, we still have not reached the dream, as maybe in Japan and Korea and Thailand and other countries, of universal healthcare, childcare, insurance, pension, pani, water and sanitation. We don't have this basic social protection for the mass of workers, for more than 400 million workers of this country. These can be provided through the cooperative, as we heard also in the Kerala model. Fourth, it leads to leadership and democratic functioning of cooperatives, particularly if I speak of women cooperatives. For the first time, women are encouraged to be leaders because they run their own cooperatives. There is an increase in women's workforce participation. Unfortunately, India has falling workforce participation of women. It's a matter of shame and concern both. So through cooperatives, we can have economic empowerment of women. And the fifth learning, of course, there are many more, but the fifth learning is that cooperatives are a laboratory for democracy. We are very proud that India is a democratic country. We've had free and fair elections. But of course, that has to reach the last, the poorest, and the weakest in our country. And we are still, there's a gap in that. So we are laboratories for democracy. And we have found that this leads to a more just and equitable society. Finally, what do we need? We need an enabling environment. I would like us to today, on this wonderful celebration of International Cooperative Day, to remind ourselves that cooperatives are to be autonomous, they are to be non-exploitative, they should be as close to the workers as possible. As a women's movement, as a women's union, we would also insist that there should be a boost to women's leadership. Wherever there are cooperatives, agriculture, farmers' cooperatives in this country, women are the farmers of this country. But when it comes to running our own cooperatives, we are nowhere. We are not ready to tolerate this anymore. The third, we should give a boost to women cooperatives. We have 8 lakh cooperatives in this country, perhaps, and less than 1% are women cooperatives. This is unacceptable. those of us who are in women cooperatives and running federations of women's cooperatives, we would like access to finance, capacity building, social security, support with marketing, especially from our government. We'd like to be part of the digital economy so we can have higher incomes like everybody else. And we would like capacity building for good governance. We believe women cooperatives can show the way. We know how to run our cooperatives in a fair, just, transparent, and nurturing manner.